for this next season. But while we continue our worship and before Junius goes out, we're going to welcome Carl Williams, a very valued member of our board, to bring and lead us around communion, if you can give him a hand.
Amen. Before I do communion, I'm just going to say a couple of things about what we just heard. So Belinda and I and the girls started coming to this church in July 2009. Wasn't long thereafter that Mark said to me, can you get involved in the board and can you have a look at some of the, just help us out with the finances. And I can remember a number of Saturdays sitting in the finance room out there with Patrick McStay, going through bank recs, the balance sheet, all the normal accounting things, working through. And what you have seen and what you're sitting in today is a miracle. Is a miracle. Because not only did we borrow money to buy here, to build here, but all the things that we enjoy every Sunday as you come in, it's purchases that have been made over those years. And God has been faithful. You have been faithful. And if you think about Sunday, just where Lou said, the offering is the white box at the back, or you can give online and give at the desk and that's it. And it's because I believe in how this church, through Pastor Mark and Bron, and now Pastor Lou and Felix, how they have honoured God, God has then honoured us as a church. Two things I want to say. Firstly, part of the reason why this church is blessed, continues to be blessed, and I'm a firm believer in this, is the way that Lou and Felix honour the past. They honour our founding pastors. And you saw that just then, but you hear, and at any time over the last 4 years when they speak about Mark and Bron in love, and they honour. And I sincerely believe that it's one of the reasons we are continually blessed, the way that you honour our founding pastors. I also just, two things, and Lou said this morning in our prayer meeting beforehand, be led by the Spirit. So I am. I'm going to say two things. One is, and I sat there during worship, and I believe God has a word for someone here or a couple of people, and I've tried to write it down. And God says, I have placed you here for a specific reason. And I didn't know what Mark and Bron were going to say. It says, like Mark and Bron were builders of this church, God wants you and wants to use you to build his kingdom in this house. God's telling someone here to go, and if you're saying, well, why am I here? God wants to say to you, why? Spend some time with him and let him speak to you and let you know why you are here. We've all been given gifts. All of us are different. God's given you something specific. Use it. Let him speak to you to use it. And the second thing that I want to, and excuse me while I go to my phone, because I want to, and to talk about something. God has a number of names in the Bible. And one of them is Jehovah Jireh. And it says, the meaning of Jehovah Jireh is the Lord will provide. And so Abraham called that place the Lord will provide, as it is on the mount of the Lord it shall be provided, in Genesis 22:14. It's the only time in the Bible that we know that it says Jehovah Jireh, God will provide. It's a beautiful name for God because it reflects his faithfulness and how he keeps his promise that all things will work out for his good. God knows exactly what is going on in your life and he will provide. So some of you may be sitting here and as Lou just said about cost of living, it's around, it's impacting everyone. But God is a provider. We've just seen that. In what has been, you know, demonstrated by paying off loan. Our loan was with the NAB. And I can remember that in one of those years when interest rates were going up, we went to the NAB to talk about the renegotiation of our loan. And it's different for a commercial property to a home loan. And often the requirements of the bank is a lot more strenuous. And we're not a big church. But you know, God moved in that time in miracles when we went and renegotiated with the NAB. And again, through that, it's just again, just like there, and I feel this morning, God is saying, in as all this you hear about cost of living and the impact on us as individuals, God is our provision. He owns the cattle on a thousand hills. Know that this morning. Know that God has a provision for you. Believe it. Take it into your heart. As much as you hear things and you may see things in the natural, there are spiritual realms and God works in that area in each of our lives. I feel very strongly on that this morning. I'm sorry. That's what I felt God speak to me about before I came and during the service. Know that you are here for a reason. You are here today to hear something. Open our ears. Let God speak to your heart this morning. So as we gather around the communion table, the message that I've, or little words that I've written down, and it says, and I've titled it, "What Are You Thankful For?" Last week, Suresh spoke, and he used the word, and one of the scriptures he gave, and if you haven't heard the message, listen to it, Psalm 100 verse 4, it says, "Enter his gates with thanksgiving," semicolon. This is the New Living Translation. "Go into his courts with praise," full stop. "Give thanks to him and praise his name." Now, I'm interested in, and sometimes in school these days, grammar's not as taught probably as much as what we used to speak, but a semicolon, and I looked it up, is a punctuation mark that connects two separate but related thoughts. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, semicolon. Go into his courts with praise. The other translation I looked at and I love is the Message Bible, and it says, "Enter with the password, thank you. Make yourselves at home, talking praise. Thank him, worship him." Blinda, the girls and I lived in New York for 3 years. And every year, the fourth Thursday of November is Thanksgiving in the US. Arguably, it is considered the most important holiday in the US calendar. I said arguably. And if the number of people, and if you've ever been to the US in November or lived in the US, if you've travelled in the US in the third week of November, it's horrendous. Because everyone travels, everyone goes to see family and friends. Traditionally, Thanksgiving Day has been a celebration of the blessings for the past year, and it originated around the 1600s to celebrate and to say thank you for the harvest. In the second year of my New York assignment, I worked for a manager who was an American. And just before Thanksgiving Day in 2018, Taylor sent all of us on his team an email. And I distinctly remember that email to this day. In fact, I went and found it. And it was sent to people like me who were not raised in the US. And it said, "Team, not all of you have had the chance to spend time in the USA during the Thanksgiving holiday, but it is my favourite time of the year. I'm going to share a few things that I am thankful for. If you are up to it, reply all and share your list." And he wrote a healthy, loving family, something else about a pastime that he likes to do, and where we work. And I actually replied. And so it went to about 30 people. And I said, "Taylor, thank you for sharing. I am truly thankful for an inspiring wife who has a heart of kindness and generosity, two beautiful daughters who are uniquely different, passionate, with strong values and being able to work for a company where I enjoy. This simple email, although now nearly 5 years ago, resonates with me today and more so this morning. So often we forget to say thank you to people for the small things that are done for us, whether it's done by our spouse, our kids, our family or our friends. A simple thank you goes such a long way and shows you genuinely care. In leadership, they talk about writing thank you on a card and giving it to your staff, because that can speak volumes to the relationship that you have with your team, but also instills in them a genuine respect for you as a leader. And sometimes it's even a powerful way. Just think, when someone gives you a card that says thank you, what does it mean to you? The cross that's over here, every time I walk into this building, I look at that cross and I think about what it means to me. The imagery that that cross gives about Jesus dying on that cross for you and for me. With respect to Jesus' death on the cross, how much should we say thank you? How much does Jesus mean to you? Communion, and it's significant to us as believers, is such an important foundation of our faith. It speaks to us in so many different ways. I started with Psalm 100, verse 4, that says, enter with the password, thank you. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Just as Taylor asked me in 2018 what I was thankful for, today my question to you is very simple. As you look and reflect on the cross, whether you want to look at that here or you close your eyes, what are you thankful for? As we take the communion this morning, I'm asking you to personify what you are thankful for. Don't worry about the person next to you, but what are you thankful for? I've written down a few things: God's forgiveness, his love, the power of Jesus' blood, and that was shed for you and me, the name of Jesus that is above every name, his faithfulness to you, his provision for you and your family, that Jehovah Jireh that I spoke about, and the goodness of God. There's a song that speaks volumes. And when this song came out, I can remember distinctly, and it's a number of years ago, and it says, thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid. Bearing all my sin and shame, in love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord. Thank you for your nail-pierced hands. Washed me in your cleansing flow. Now all I know, your forgiveness and embrace. Worthy is the Lamb. This morning, as you take the communion that's next to you in the chair, as you take it, let's take it with a grateful heart. But I'm asking you to close your eyes and say, what are you thankful for? What are you thankful for this morning? What in regards to that cross and what our Lord and Saviour has done for us? So as we take communion this morning, it is a bit hard to open. So if you take your cup and the bread, and Mark 14, 22 to 25, it says, while they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body. Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many, he said. Do it in remembrance of this me. So this morning, if you have not already, take the bread and the juice and close your eyes and just say, thank you, Lord. Thank you for what you have done in my life. Let's take this now. Let's pray. Father God, I just thank you for the power of the cross. I thank you, Lord, for what you have done for each one of our lives. Lord, we are so thankful. Thank you, thankful for our salvation. Thankful for your forgiveness, for your love, for your healing, for your grace that was poured out for each one of us. Lord, let us never take it for granted. Let us always remember what you have done for each of us. Lord, this morning as we celebrate what you have done for us as a congregation, we now take it as an individual and each of us say, thank you, Lord. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for what it means to each of us. Lord, this morning as we have worshipped together collectively, Lord, we worship you as individuals. And we just say, worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb that is slain for us. And we thank you for the power of the blood and the name of Jesus this morning. We ask these things in your name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lou.
Thank you so much, Carl. All right, Junior Youth, you have 15 minutes. Go for it. It's really important to say thank you. I don't know if you've ever given a gift and someone hasn't said thank you. You really notice it. I wonder if God feels the same way. It's like, I did that. You didn't say thank you. Josh, do you mind joining me up here? I'm not going to preach a sermon. I'm going to share with you a parable and a thought this morning. A parable and a thought around what God has spoken to me about us as a church and our next steps. The thought is, sow, don't bury. Sow, don't bury. To sow, if you want to throw up the next slide, Phoebes, to sow means, it's actually, to sow and to bury is very similar because you're putting something in the ground. If you see the pictures, to sow is to remove dirt and to put a seed in the ground. And to bury is to dig a hole and put something in the ground. But the intent and the heart behind that is a significant difference. So I'm going to read a parable that you would be really familiar with in many translations. It's called the Parable of the Talents. But I'm going to read it in the Message translation this morning because I knew that many would be familiar with other translations. So if you want to read along with me, Matthew 25, 14 to 30, and may God speak to you about this next season for us as a church. The story about investment. Jesus said, it's also like a man going off on an extended trip. He called his servants together and he delegated them responsibilities. To one, he gave $5,000, and to another, he gave $2,000. And to a third one, he gave, depending on their abilities, he gave $1,000. And then he left. And right off, the first servant went to work and he doubled his master's investment. The second did the same. But the man with the single $1,000, he dug a hole and he carefully buried his master's money. After a long absence, the master of those servants came back and settled with them. The one given $5,000, showed him how he doubled his investment from $5,000 to $10,000. Look, I can do maths. Woo. His master commended him, good work, you did a good job. From now on, we're going to be partners. The servant with the $2,000 showed how he'd also doubled his investment. His master commended him, good work. You did a good job, well done. From now on, you're going to be my partner. But the servant who was given $1,000 said, Master, I know you have really high standards and you hate careless ways, that you demand the best and make no allowances for error. I was afraid I might disappoint you, so I found a really good hiding place. secured your money, and here it is, safe and sound to the last cent. The master was furious. That's a terrible way to live. It's criminal to live cautiously. It's criminal to live cautiously like that. Other translations actually say, and I recently heard Pastor Mark Varughese preach out of this scripture, he called him wicked and lazy, which seems a bit harsh because he may be lazy, but wicked. In multiple translations, he says, you wicked and lazy servant. It's interesting in the Message translation, it says, if you knew I was after the best, why did you do less than the least? Why did you do less than the least? The least you could have done would be to invest the sum with the bankers, or at least I would have gotten a little interest. And then he took the 1,000 that he'd given to the one and he gave it to the person who had risked the most. And he said, get rid of this, play it safe, who won't go out of on a limb. Throw him out into utter darkness. Sounds pretty intense. So don't bury. Carl was talking about every one of us being given different talents. We're all given a certain amount as to a degree of what God's given us. But this parable is really clear that the kingdom principle is that we sow what we have. Pastor Bron spoke about the widow's mind. It doesn't mean about having how much you have, it's what you do with what you have. So my call to us as a church is that we would sow and not bury. We're not going to go into a season and think, well, thank God we've paid off the loan, dig a hole and sit on it and get comfortable. We're going to remain to be a place that sows for the kingdom of God. But I'm just not talking about money. We are into seed ministry of everything. You know your time, we sow our time. We sow what we have. We sow of our heart. Sowing involves risk. The thing about the kingdom is I'm going to invest and I don't know if I'll get anything in return. That's a kingdom principle of sowing. I'm going to sow into your life because God has called me to sow and to give. Jesus said it's far better to give than to receive. Kingdom principle isn't I'm going to give, what am I going to get out of it? When we sow for the kingdom of God like that, we have our reward in full. I'll never forget hearing Christine Kane, I don't know, some of you may have heard her share this story. She preached at this massive conference and everyone's standing on their feet cheering her. She got down and she sat down next to Joyce Meyer. And Joyce Meyer said to her, I hope you enjoyed that applause. Because that's all the reward you're going to get for that. God calls us kingdom principles. We sow, not based on what we're going to get back, but we've been called to sow. And when we get our reward here on earth, it's actually, they say, that's your reward in full. We're called to sow in secret, to sow according to what God puts on our heart. Seed ministry, sowing involves risk. There's no guarantee. To live a life expressed through kingdom principles. But it actually said it's wicked and lazy to withhold what I have, to bury it and not sow it and invest it. May we sow what God has called us to sow. I just want to share with you a few mustard seed ministries, and I want to give you a stat about our backyard. So in 2009, and I see Felicity's here, that was the year Felicity Dyer came. And she brought the playgroup. We didn't have the backyard. 2009, we launched Eastcoast Playgroup. If you can follow with this. So it's been running for 14 years. For the first 7 years, we did check-ins via paper. So we have no record for how many people attended it. But the second 7 years, we had an online database. So we recorded check-ins. Of that second seven lots of years, it's very biblical, 7 years. The second seven lots of years, including 2 years of lockdown, 1,500 people, and we cut out all church members, we didn't count church members, 1,500 members of our community have been through our playgroup doors and have been touched by that ministry. So for me, that's a conservative number to consider if we double, because the playgroup has gone up and down like that in numbers. We can conservatively say 2,000 plus is a conservative assumption has been touched through this building, through this ministry, lives change, seed ministry. But you know why it's a seed ministry? Because when you come and you put a seed in the ground, I'm going to set up a bunch of toys. That's sowing a seed of my time. It is a seed ministry that goes on to produce a harvest. Seed sowing happens when I show up and I'm literally going to get my hands dirty and invest what God has put in my life. And it's our heart that this church will continue to sow seeds for the kingdom. Playgroups are seed ministry. Do you know we've got other seed ministries happening in this church now you don't even know about? We have a kids band. We are literally training the next generation of worshippers. You didn't even know it's happening because we didn't want to put too much pressure on it, but it's a seed ministry. We said we need to raise up the next generation of worship leaders, but someone like Rio said, I'll sow the seed. I'll come every Tuesday. I'll make the investment. It's the people that were willing, like Mark and Bron Bridgewater, I'll sow the seed. I'll sow the seed of faith. The Bible says a mustard seed of faith can shift a mountain. We often think it's in the big things, but it's actually in the small things. Stick around long enough to watch a tree grow. I'll never forget when those trees were planted. 2014, it was the year Evander was born. 9 years, those trees have flourished. The kingdom, things grow slowly. Have you ever noticed that? But it's the intention of our heart that we sow without an expectation of what God's going to give back to me. I sow because I've been born to sow seeds of faith, to give and to multiply. That's what Jesus taught me, because when he poured out his life on the cross, he says, if you want to be a leader, then you're going to serve. In this kingdom, the first will be last and the last will be first. That it is great, there's no greater love than to lay down your life for a friend. This kingdom sowing, it's not about giving to get, it's actually giving and trusting God, whatever you're going to do with it. I give my time and my resources to God and I say, whatever you do with it, God, I trust you. I'm going to trust you. Sowing versus burying, there's a big difference. Burying is comfortability. There's a wickedness in bearing because you're withholding what God's put in you that's going to bless someone else. Andrea, if you didn't, just last week's whole Sunday service, you've got to go back and watch. But Andrea stood up and spoke about how she felt so intimidated to run the playgroup because of what the enemy had said with, your English isn't good enough. The playgroup has flourished under Andrea. The seed was her yes, God. That's the seed and it's multiplied. She didn't withhold it. She stepped forward in faith. It's the seemingly small moves. I guess I'm here to say we're just not going to do cautious living. God hasn't called us to live cautiously. We're going to be an audacious church that tries to do far more than it seems like what they can do. Because that is our heritage. Our heritage is a heritage of ground-taking, faith-breaking faith. And that's what we're going to pick up that mantle. Another seed ministry, as could I have the whole team just come up? Do you know running a connect group is a seed ministry? People that open up their homes are my greatest heroes. Every week that say I'm going to sow into the lives of people, those people are heroes. Seed sowers. Thank you, Suresh. Guess that whole parable, what it drills down to is a word called stewardship. What have I done with what God has put in my hand? I'm actually accountable. So the parable is God says, all right, you've got this amount of time on earth and I will come back. Jesus is coming back. And I've given you this certain amount. And it's not about if you have 5,000, if you have 2,000, or if you have one. Nearly came off the step. No. It's not about how much you were given. It was, what did you do with what you were given? And did you sow it? Did you sow it for a return? Did you sow with a risk? Faith involves risk. To bury is a place of comfort. What's next? I believe our greatest days of sowing are ahead of us as a church. But we do honour the past, because I know we wouldn't be here if they weren't willing to take that faith leap. But I'm going to honour the past by being faithful to the future of what God has called us to do. Our greatest days of sowing and seeing the kingdom of God expanded are ahead of us. Will you sow with us? And I'm not talking about money. It seems to be that God hasn't got an issue with money. I'm talking about sowing our lives into the kingdom of God and seeing it multiply. Would you all just stand to your feet? What's amazing to me, and this is just a personal blessing for me, is that when the year 2004, when they had the faith to purchase this building, was the very same year, I'm going to get emotional, that I walked in the doors of that red brick building, and that that this community was a spirit-filled community, and I met Jesus, and I encountered the Spirit of God, and my whole life was completely changed because of their faith to expand the kingdom of God. It was never about a building. It was always about the people. It's always been about the people. Would you just close your eyes in this moment? And as we prepare to close the service, I really had on my heart that there's seed dreams that God is putting in people's hearts this morning for the kingdom. Ministries, callings. There's things that God wants to sow. And some of you maybe are not even used to hearing from God. Like you see a vision or a picture when we're worshiping and you're not used to it. I really felt that with our young guys just down the front here. Maybe you're not used to hearing from God, or you think when we worship, God shows you a picture. I encourage you to write that down. I really felt as we were worshiping that God was speaking to the young people in this room. And if you could actually hear it, you're seeing things for the future. And when you're 18, God showed me things as an 18-year-old that I'm now seeing now. It's the wildest thing. You can't imagine being as old as I am now when you're at the age you are. But that God would reveal things to you. And I would like to awaken dormant dreams for others. Bring it to their remembrance. We are living in strange and unusual times, and the church needs to be ready. God is speaking to you right now. He's reawakening things. I'm not afraid of what God is saying to you. And you might freak out because it feels big. But I have an expectation that dreams are awakening in this place. Seed dreams, something so small. Father God, I thank you that you call us to be partners in your kingdom. Just as that parable said, that you entrust us. And you call us to be partners in your work, and it is such a joy to work alongside you, God. And today is a significant day because this church exists and it doesn't belong to anybody. It belongs to you, God. This is your church. This is your building, God. But this is a stake in the ground, and the enemy knows that this church is not going anywhere. And we break the stronghold that is over our Sutherland Shire, and we say it belongs to Jesus. We pray over every single high school that is within our area. We pray over the families. We pray over marriages. We pray where there's an issue with crime and drugs. We pray for people that are stuck in lives of addiction. We pray that this would be a house of prayer, a house of worship, a house of healing. And we thank you for the 28 years that have been within this church. And we pray and we prophesy for the next 28 to 30 years ahead. We thank you that in those children's church right now are the pastors and the leaders of this church. We thank you that you have given us everything that we need to fulfill the gospel of Jesus Christ. We have more than enough, and we're going to go. And we pray that we would be faithful with what you've put in our hands. But all glory to God this morning. All glory to you, God. And I feel so thankful to be a part of this church. I'm so thankful. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Oh, yeah, come on.
I had a word from God during the worship, and it was stand and see the salvation of God. And I thought, why am I getting that? I've got nothing else. It's stand and see the salvation of God. And I didn't understand, and I didn't know that the church had been paid off. I did not know. But the word is still coming, and I'm impelled to say, stand and see what God can do in your life. Stand and see, move, be active in what God can do and is doing in your life. Stand and see the salvation of God. Stand and see what Jesus wants to do with you. Be active. Do not sit. It says stand and see the salvation. Jesus is the salvation. Jesus is our salvation. He is our life. He is our life that gives us joy. He is our life that gives us fulfillment and meaning and peace. Things the world cannot give you. The world cannot give you peace, fulfillment and joy. It doesn't happen. But Jesus is our salvation. Stand and see the salvation of God. Rise up in your heart, rise up in your attitude and say, yes, God, I want you to use me. Lord Jesus, I got nothing that I know of, but whatever I've got, I want to invest it in you. I want to put it in you and see you do what you can do, because you are God. You can bring a harvest out of a drought. You can bring something out of nothing, and I have nothing within myself but what you have given me, and I give it to you, Lord Jesus. Stand in your heart and say, yes, Jesus, use me. Use me, Lord Jesus. Use me, Lord Jesus, with whatever way you want to. I can't see how you're going to do it, or I may be able to see how you're going to do it, but I offer my life to you. I offer you my talents, I offer you my strength, I offer you my family, I offer you my job, I offer you my very breath. For without you, I have nothing. It is in you, Lord Jesus, that I live and breathe and have my being. I give you great thanks, Lord, for just being alive, for being in this country. I give you thanks, Lord, and I praise you and I worship you, because you are my salvation, Jesus.
Told me to play tag team with Dave. I really felt like I had a word during the worship before everything else was announced. So I'll just say what God was talking to me. And it's almost like preachy, but anyway, I'm going to say it. Is the man that built his house on the sand, he looks and he sees the storm coming and he's filled with fear. But the man who built his house on the rock sees the storm coming and he shrugs his shoulders and goes, so what? And what I'm talking about here, and what God was showing me, is it's our confidence is in who our rock is. It's in God. It's in Jesus. And that's the faith that Mark and Bron had when they bought this place. It's standing on the rock. It's that faith that we have, that we know who our God is. And you know what? It doesn't matter what the world throws at us, whether it's economic whatever, or, you know, woke agenda stuff, or who cares, whatever it is that the world wants to throw at us, if we know who our God is, if we know who our rock is, we're on solid ground. Amen. And we're not shaken. Amen.
As Lou was praying, I saw people walking through those doors, the doors of church. And they're not just any people. They're people who vehemently deny God. They curse his name. They hate God. But I see them changing. I see Sauls becoming Pauls. I see those people who, the very people who hate God, the very people who give you trouble, I see those very people becoming your allies, the allies of the kingdom. And I see them walking through those doors, and by the doors, they leave their chains. I see their chains on the floor, broken. And with their chains broken, so is their past, for they are forgiven and made anew through the blood of Jesus. In Jesus' name.
So could you end on a high note, a bit of a praise party? If there's any day that we could dance, it's a day like today. Let's throw it on you. You got anything? Yeah? Yeah, good. All right, I'll get it out of the way.
Young guys, come down the front here. Get down the front. Down east, Josiah, I know you want to come out the front, mate. Get down the front. Come on, guys, come down the front. Let's praise him at the front.
That silences the enemies, and let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety, and let it rise, let praise arise. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything. We sing with all we are and we claim your victory, and let it rise. Praise arise, let it rise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. For fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you.
Breakthroughs on our side forever.
Praise you, God. Thanks for being here, church. Come join us for a coffee out the backyard. We'll see you next week.